Believe it or not, my last name is easier. Andy did a great job of telling my last name. My first name is the harder one. It's actually Cengiz. It's a Turkish C, it's a J, it's kind of the tough one, but the last name is actually easier. And no more multicast, actually, at least not in this talk. And I'm going to switch back to the SDN, and then analytics is a new session, actually. And this is the typical SDN architecture with the three tier. And then you have the devices at the bottom, SDN controller, and then the applications on the top. The revolution of the SDN is the programmability of the network. That means actually the revolution is in the apps. It's not the controller, it's not the southbound protocols and so forth. These are all the enablers. And today actually I'm going to mostly talk about a particular app, but before I go there, I want to start with a question. If the applications now can make programmatic changes to the network, what governs that this is actually good? What governs that the changes that the applications make to the network are actually good and they're not going to hurt the network, they're not going to hurt other services, and so forth? And the answer is basically analytics. The analytics-powered applications can actually make this and actually make our lives easier. And yesterday, in the majority of the keynotes, at least everyone at least attributed some piece of the importance of the analytics and so forth. But often we do not talk too much about analytics. We talk a lot about telemetry, and telemetry is absolutely a must. It's an enabler. Without telemetry, you cannot do any of the analytics. But telemetry itself is not analytics. Analytics is like what you do with this data. It's the data mining. It's basically identifying trends in the data, identifying what is normal, what is abnormal, and getting alerts when you reach abnormal conditions and so forth. But more importantly, actually associating semantics with the data. I mean, there are a lot of big data projects. They see that, oh, this company has done something great with the big data, and then, let's do the same thing. And they hire some Hadoop experts and stuff like this. They give them the data, but the guy is not a domain expert. He doesn't know the semantics of the data. To do a big data analytics, you must have hypotheses, and you may have, theories, and then you use the data to actually validate. So it's really the analytics is what you do with that data. And networking, you can collect the topology, BGP data, performance data, traffic flows, and so forth. And then, you can just have fancy graphs of this, but that's not sufficient. You must actually have actionable conclusions from this data. For example, if you're a service provider, you can use the traffic data to balance your BGP peering traffic or find a cheaper transit provider for you based on the destinations that you go to and so forth. Or for your IGP, you can actually set off paths in the network, but maybe RSVPTA tunnels, maybe IGP tuning, IGP metric tuning, and so forth, so that you don't have congestion in the network or you alleviate congestion and so forth. Analytics also provide visibility into the network, especially with the SDN. This becomes very critical because changes are no longer made by the operators. It's done by the software. When they work, everything is great. It's automated, and we save a lot of operational cost and complexity and so forth. But when they break, how do you diagnose it? Actually, this was also in the Nuaj presentation yesterday. Basically, if there's a problem in the overlay, how do you know what in the underlay caused that particular problem? All of these can be actually addressed by analytics. And of course, analytics empowers applications so that when the applications make changes to the network, it's actually better for the network. It doesn't actually hurt. But where does the analytics fit in the three-layer architecture? Obviously, it is not in the devices. The devices provide the telemetry data. If you go back 4 or 5 years ago into the early SDN slice, we said analytics will be in the controllers. That's not what happened, unfortunately. There are multiple reasons for that. First, the controllers become commodity, and people looked at analytics as value add, crown jewels of the company, and so forth. They kept them for themselves. That's one reason. The other reason is controller is really a control plane device. You don't want to be doing big data analytics in the controller. You want to actually take that to the management plane. You could put the analytics to each of the applications. From where I'm standing, I can't really point. For example, the traffic engineering application. And the problem with that, one application has the analytics, the other one doesn't have it, or one application doesn't know what's happening with the other application and so forth. Because of that, actually, a new layer is being introduced into the SDN architecture. We started saying this about a year ago, but just last week, actually, a couple of open source projects also started doing management and orchestration. Basically, this is where you put your analytics. You put your analytics on top of your controller, and then you write your applications on top of that. And in this talk, I'm going to talk about this layer as well as an application that uses the analytics to actually, you know, change the network, actually do the network for the better of the network. And what we built is this platform. And then, you know, it has the usual telemetry monitoring of the network. We monitor both the devices, both physical and virtual devices, as well as the controllers. You could get everything from the controller if you trust your controller as well as your devices. Because, you know, controller may say, I set this state, and the router may say, okay, I received that, but actually, you know, it may have failed to do that. You actually, it's best to actually monitor both of these pieces at the same time. And there is an, it's really hard to point, there is an orchestration component on the left-hand side that actually, you know, any decisions that you want to do and you want to execute it, that talks to the controllers. And there may be a bunch of controllers. It doesn't have to be a single controller. It talks to the controllers, and then controllers talk to the devices to set the stage. This way, there is a clear separation of responsibility. From the current state, you come up with the models of the network. You have the topology model of the network. You have the traffic model. These are traffic matrices, performance model, delay, loss, and jitter, and things like that. And there is a significant policy component. And the policy is, again, one of those very abstract terms. People talk a lot. But really, to really talk about the policy, you must first think of an application, because the policy is different based on the application. And I'll talk about the policy in the application that I'm going to present. And there's an optimization component that basically you are usually trying to reduce something. You're reducing the congestion, or maybe you're saving costs on your optical line cards and things like that. But there is an optimization component. And there's also predictive analytics. That's actually very important too, because some of the SDN applications may not be changing the network state as it is right now. For example, you may say, hey, tonight there is this particular broadcast, maybe a soccer game or a football game or something, and then you say, I need to make sure the network can handle these particular conditions. For that, the current real time is not sufficient. You need to actually estimate what's going to happen at night, and you can actually do that by looking at the past trends. Again, this would have been something very hard to do in the controller, because you have to basically, you know, come up with trends. Are you trying to be part of the control plane? Are you trying to be the, you know, data analytics and so forth? On top of this, there is definitely open RESTful APIs. And this is very critical for multiple reasons. First, it enables applications, not just for us, but by also some of our customers and third parties and so forth. And also, usually the revolution, the software revolution, is not just about somebody's platform. You know, we talk to our customers, and what they tell us is, you're going to be one of our 10, 20 or so SDN service providers. When we want to do end-to-end service orchestration, we are going to pick components from you, components from them. We just need to make sure we have API so that, you know, we may pick your traffic matrix, somebody else's algorithm, or, you know, or we push the traffic matrix to you from some other system. Basically, everything has to be, you know, this plug-and-play microservices kind of an architecture. So this is the management and orchestration platform that the applications are written on top of. I am going to talk about the SDN traffic engineering application, and it's really for the wide area network. And the way this application typically works, you know, you have the networks, you have the telemetry. From telemetry, you come up with basically three things. One, the topology. Second piece is the traffic matrix. Third piece is the policy. Policy would be, in this case, basically, what are you trying to optimize? And then from this, you come up with recommendations. And you may be, these recommendations may be either, you know, link metrics, or it can also be tunnel paths, or, you know, paths in the network. Both of these basically determine the paths in the network. You come up with what paths in the network, and then you use the SDN controller, and then you provision this. Then, you know, you go back to monitoring the network. It's a full circle, basically. This is typically how this application works. This is actually how this application worked 20 years ago, too. And there are a lot of products based on that. But today's networks actually runs multi-services. What does this mean? I mean, in the past, service providers on different networks for different things. For example, for enterprises, they run a frame relay network, they provided connections over that one. But all of these have moved to IP/MPLS technology. And more importantly, they moved on top of the same backbone. Usually the edge devices are different, but the backbone devices, the core routers are the same. You know, you have the edges, and then all of these are running on top of the same network. What do you have on that network? You have best effort internet where people are watching YouTube and Netflix and this and that. You have business VPNs. You have, you know, a mobile backhaul network if you have a mobile component to it. You may be having an IPTV and other things. But these services actually have different needs. I mean, for example, they peak at different times. Even if you just take the internet traffic, let's say, you know, watching YouTube, Netflix, whatever, right? If you are in the US, you have East Coast, West Coast, and two other time zones, not that populated. But anyway, people watch at different times in the East Coast and the West Coast. So the traffic peaks at different times. They grow at different rates. And then they need different performance requirements. And then, you know, also resiliency also. They have different requirements. Yeah, give an example, financial enterprise, if you have a customer like that, you know, they are willing to pay big bucks as long as you can cut down 1 millisecond of delay. You are not going to optimize that traffic just like you optimize the, you know, YouTube, Netflix traffic. And if you look at the, you know, video streaming, for example, that one typically peaks at night, whereas the business traffic peaks during the day. And then it's not delay sensitive. You can actually route it through a long path, but you know it is more jitter sensitive, and it's also very adaptive to losses. If you, for example, if you suddenly have failures in your network, you can actually, you know, a little bit choke that traffic. It will still be acceptable for your end users to watch. It won't be as clear, but you can still watch whatever they were watching, and so forth. Whereas in the financial case, you must actually provide high number of nines of availability. And then, you know, there is usually penalties if you didn't do that. So how do we do that for when you are running multiple services in the network? This basically means that this mono layer needs to know all of these services. Any analytics that you do know, you have to know about this. You cannot just have one traffic matrix for everything. You must have different traffic matrices for different parts of your network, different services running on the network, and so forth, as well as the policy. Okay, so what does it mean for us? We are talking about the traffic engineering app, now switch to more specifics. So basically, you need a traffic matrix as well as policy for each of these services. And for traffic matrix, depending on the app or the service, you know, you may have, or the way you want to run your network, you may want to do full mesh of traffic engineering. For example, you may want to do traffic engineering tunnels from your edge devices to all the other edge devices. This is not unusual for a mobile operator where the network is a little bit smaller, and whereas most of the full meshes usually happen core to core and so forth. But you can actually have multiple of these. You can say, hey, my East Coast traffic and West Coast traffic are totally different. I'm going to have one matrix for the East Coast, another matrix for the West Coast. You can have multiple of these. And you can do tactical traffic engineering. What does that mean? That means instead of, you know, full mesh of tunnels, I mean, quite a few service providers are not too comfortable with 20, 30,000 tunnels. And what they would like to do, hey, I have congestion in these two, three links. Can I just identify those and then just move traffic away from them? You can do this one as well. And you can use the peak data, average or 95th percentile data over a day or a week or a month and so forth. What does this mean? So when you do traffic engineering, you can actually pick the worst for every single link or worst for every single region and so forth. But if you combine them all together, that becomes so pessimistic that you would actually provision so much bandwidth that you do not need. So what we do instead, you say, okay, hey, I'm interested daily 95th percentile for this particular traffic matrix. You may have multiple regions, and each one of them, they have their own different 95th percentile. We will actually monitor the traffic levels. We will figure out when the 95th percentile for that whole entire region is reached, and we will use the values from that time. And you can do this multiple times of the day. If you want a different traffic matrix for daytime versus nighttime, you can actually do that as well. But ultimately, you have to have a traffic matrix for each service. You need one for the enterprises, another one for the over-the-top video, and so forth. The policy component is also very important. But as I said, this is very hard to talk in the abstract. I mean, I have done policy before I joined packet design in the 90s. It was all about BGP policy, and it's quite different than the TE policy. In the case of TE policy, It means the optimization algorithm. What am I trying to optimize? Is it is it a simple greedy algorithm? Is it am I willing to pay the price and have a really machine and deep machine learning based algorithm? AI algorithms are all the hype these days. Or is it like a financial enterprise where my optimization is very simple? I just want the shortest delay. And the delay here doesn't mean the link metric. It actually really means the delay, IPSLA values and so forth, 1 millisecond, 5 millisecond, actual values which change dynamically and so forth. And then, do I create tunnels? Am I free to create as much as tunnels as I want, or am I trying to minimize that number? As I said, quite a few service providers would like to keep that small as well. And often these tunnels end up being on the IGP paths. There is no reason to create them. Or if there's a really large amount of traffic and I split it into multiple paths, am I using RSVPTE or segment routing and so forth? Or, can I under or over provision this traffic? All of these are the policy components. It's very easy to talk about the policy when you have an application in mind. But if you just talk about in the SDN umbrella, I have listened to people talk about policy. I kind of like, oh God, what are they saying?
5 minutes.
Thank you. Okay, let me illustrate an example of this. We have a test bed, which is this one. Actually, you can see the demo upstairs if you stop by. And there is one elephant flow that is going from the west to east. There is another one, not as big, going north to south as well. It is a gigabit per second network, and this particular elephant flow is 850 megabit per second. So no matter where you put this traffic, no matter how you reroute it, it's going to create congestion. It's going to create 85% link utilization, whatever link it hits. Only way to basically get rid of congestion in this network, because there are multiple paths, is to split it into multiple places. And I talked about analytics and how it helps you visualize and so forth. The way you start the workflow is basically by actually visualizing the network. The first thing that you look at your network for this particular traffic matrix, this happens to be the business traffic matrix, the daytime. And then, how is my network doing? Basically, network at this time is 93%. The worst link utilization in the network is 93% utilized. That means there is congestion. That means there is high delay. That means basically customers will not be happy about this particular the experience that they get. The delay that they get, the max delay in the network is 12 milliseconds. That's probably acceptable. And so it's a small network, obviously. And these are the other links in the network. There are a few links, which is in the red. That's the congested range, 85% and up. Some links more than 65%. Green is up to 45%. Those are the links that doesn't have congestion. And this is the traffic matrix at the bottom. How much traffic is going from west to edge? That's the big elephant, 850. How much is going from west to north? That's only 50. These are the miles flows. But this is also, dark blue as opposed to light blue. The dark means actually the traffic is going over a congested link. It doesn't mean that it's big. It's not dark because it's 50. It means it's actually going over a link that is congested. That's what it means. And basically, here is another dark blue. And then this one is actually on the second hop. Is sharing a link that has one of the elephant flows, basically. That's why it's actually shown. So basically, by just looking at this, I know what's going on in my network. If I started here and then this thing is in green, I don't have to do traffic engineering. And my job is done, right? I mean, a lot of people have 20, 30,000 tunnels, but they actually do not know how much they're helping or, you do need to know that. You need to actually understand how the network is behaving by itself, and that's how analytics helps you with that. Anyway, the policy here happens to be, split my traffic up to 450 megabit per second. Every 450 megabit per second, I'll split that traffic. For example, that 850 traffic will become 2 425s. If it happened to be 1.2 gig, that will be 3 paths and so forth. And then, I click the recommendations. It comes back, hey, if you create these 14 tunnels, I can reduce your worst link utilization to 55%. And then you click the provision. That's where the controller comes. Controller is a critical piece. I'm not talking about it. You click the provision. You talk to the controller. It happens to be open daylight, but it could be, North Star or VIA or whatever, or Brocade. Doesn't really matter. Basically, we talk to the controller, and then controller actually talks to the routers, and then this happens. You can show that upstairs if you have some time. Stop by.
2 minutes.
And here is the tactical one. In the tactical case, I think I set the metric to 70%. Any link that is more than 70% utilized, find the sources of the traffic and just set up tunnels for those, as opposed to full mesh of tunnels. it can actually solve the same problem with just 4 tunnels. And then, you know, you provision this. But it's a full circle. You provisioned it. Did it actually happen? Did the traffic actually reduce? You must actually continue to monitor. In this case, basically, all 14 tunnels, that was the first recommendations, they all came up. They are all up, as opposed to, you know, they failed the signal or something bad happened in the network. And only 3 of them not on IGP pass. Basically, 11 of these are on the IGP pass. Actually, you don't really need those 11. That's why the tactical one was able to reduce it to 4 tunnels as well. But this is the power of analytics. This is what makes the applications, when they change the network, it's not causing harm. It's actually helping the network. In conclusion, basically, we can have a multi-services SDN in reality, and there are 3 major ingredients to that. One is was the subject of this talk, is the service-aware SDN monolayer. The second piece is SDN controllers. I don't mean to downgrade it. I mean, it's very important, but it's not the revolution. Revolution is the application itself. And then obviously standardized southbound protocols. I explicitly mentioned segment routing and YANG here. We are actually using PSAP. I didn't even put PSAP here as a necessity. In my opinion, segment routing and YANG alone can solve all of the other protocols what they are trying to do. I think the industry, if we want from the industry the simplest boxes possible, we should all go behind segment routing and YANG. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And unfortunately, I'm afraid we do not have time for questions.